Welcome to the Clallam County Report. My name is Bill Peach. I'm the Clallam County Commissioner for District 3. And today we're outside the Forks Visitor Center. I hope you enjoy the opportunity to visit the center with me. Beginning with, I'd like to say hello to our Executive Director, Lissy Andros.
Hi Bill, thanks for coming.
You're most welcome. I'm going to enjoy this.
Come on in.
Thank you. So we're in the Visitor Center with the Executive Director, Lissy Andros.
Yes.
Lissy, what is this room all about?
So this is our Ocean Room, and this is a new room for the Visitor Center. And the crown jewel of this room is a kiosk that was donated to us by the Olympic Coast National Marine Sanctuary. They partnered with NOAA, put content on this kiosk, and now we are one of three in Washington that has this kiosk. There's one in the Pacific Science Center, one here, and one down at Claylock at the Claylock Lodge. And it's a really great interactive tool, so people can just touch it, find out all sorts of information on it, from weather to videos to children's games. And it's neat because it has that second screen so that if there's several people in this room, someone can stand in the back and still see what's going on. So it's a really great piece for Forks.
And the kids can get in as
well
as the taller people?
Yes, that's right. Because, you know, people don't always associate us with the ocean, but we are an ocean town, so the ocean's only 14 miles from us. We also have over here some items that were have been loaned to us by John's Beachcombing Museum, which is a very unique museum here in Forks. We have some other treasures that the Visitor Center staff has found on the beach. And then, so we're really excited to have this room that we can have people sit down and maybe check their Wi-Fi, do the kiosk, you know, look at ocean treasures. And then if we want to come into this room, what we're featuring here is a local celebrity, and that would be Mick Dodge. And Mick was on a TV show called The Legend of Mick Dodge. So people can come and get their picture taken with Mick. So, yeah. And then, of course, we have other information, which is what we're here for, is to provide information. And then up here, we have a live webcam that's rotating through that shows Lake Crescent, Claylock, the Quinault River, ONRC, and the Push has two cameras.
And there's a lot of information here about the Olympic National Park.
Yes. So we have Olympic National Park information and forest information. And since there is no park office in Forks, we serve as the information for the National Park Office here in Forks. So we're not official, but we do the best we can.
Well, it was really helpful. I remember last year we even had forest fires in the park and people were interested.
Yes.
Where can I go? What is open? What is not? What is the situation? And he kept everybody informed.
Right. He sure did. And so that's one of our functions here at the Visitor Center. You know, another one of our draws is Twilight, which you're going to hear more about here in a second. But right here we have a little mural on our wall that shows the very first page of the Twilight Saga novel, the first installment of Twilight, and shows how it's connected to Forks and why it's set in the town of Forks.
That's beautiful.
And that was painted by a local gentleman.
So we've had an awful lot of people visit because of Twilight.
Yes.
And does that continue? Twilight's a movie that's a couple of years old now.
It does. It continues. We have a festival every fall that attracts hundreds of people. We have actors from the movies come to our festival. And even all year round, we have a ton of Twilight visitors. And this summer we're going to have Twilight props and costumes from the movie on display in downtown Forks, which we're really excited about. But since Twilight was published, we've had over 400,000 people sign our guest book.
Wow.
So it's been pretty amazing. For a town of 3,500, it's pretty amazing.
Well, I see some Twilight information in this room. Can you talk to us about what is occurring over here?
I sure can. So right now we have our Visitor Center staff helping some visitors with Twilight information and local information. And over here we have some cutouts that people take pictures with. We have a ton of fans that come to Forks specifically for Twilight and then make return trips because the area is so beautiful. So Twilight fans can get their Twilight fix over here in the corner. They can also stick a pin in the map where they're from, which you may have seen these visitors do. We have a United States map and a world map, and our visitors are international.
Well, I tell you what, I recognize the president of the Chamber of Commerce standing by the map. Can we pop in and say hello to him and understand the map?
So, as Chamber President, it never ceases to amaze me the variety of visitors we get. We're fortunate today to have a gentleman here from Geelong, in Australia. And do you want to point out on the map here, because we have pins on the map from where our visitors come from in Geelong.
So we're around there, the black blue one there.
So each one of these pins represents a visitor from a different part of the world. You see quite a few we have here from Europe, Asia. United States actually has its own map right here. We have a lot in Washington, but you also see the East Coast down into Florida. We have quite a few visitors.
So I'm here with Monica. Monica is a visitor center staffer, and one of the responsibilities of the visitor center staff is to have people sign our guest book, and we don't ask your name, just the town you're traveling from. And so so far we've had people from California, Australia, Philadelphia, San Francisco, San Diego, Brazil. So we've had people from all over the United States and all over the world just in the last week. And so that's how we keep track of our visitor center guests. And then the other thing I wanted to mention is, Monica, have you been on the trail back behind the visitor center? We have a quarter of a mile trail that we suggest to visitors. It's very rainforesty. So if you don't have 30 minutes to drive down to the rainforest, you can just walk right behind us, walk through the trail, and get a lot of rainforest photo ops. So. And it's good for dogs too, isn't it?
It's great.
Yeah, and kids.
Well, following our visit to the visitor center here in Forks, immediately adjacent is the Forks Timber Museum. And I'm very happy to share with you that we have Tom Roseman, who's actually the chair of the Timber Museum Board. And you were just mentioning to me about the history behind how this was built.
Yeah, this building, Timber Museum building, was constructed in the 1989-90 school year by the Forks High School carpentry class. Right through the middle of winter, just, you know, unfortunately, all the weather was like this all the time. So they built it right through the middle of, you know, our winters here. Rain or shine, and did a pretty good job. It's, you know, go inside, you'll see that it definitely looks like a timber museum, rustic.
Well, please, let us go in. Let's go inside. Would you introduce us to folks?
Sure. Or I'll let you. Okay, this is Linda Offit. She's the museum manager, and over there at the cash drawer is one of our new volunteers at RISBY.
Hello.
Taking care of the first customers of the day.
Visitors.
Welcome.
Thank you.
So I think, Linda, why don't you take care of the general.
The Timber Museum is very much about local history and logging industry. We have started, of course, as pioneer families, and so the early pioneer history and settlements is something that's covered well in here, as well as farming. And then, of course, we go into our logging history, and that's really what this area is known for, is our logging. Tom's family was here and had a mill, so he's very well versed in the logging industry. And what we do is we welcome visitors to come and take a look at what we have to offer on a self-guided tour. So they come through the museum and at their own pace, and then can ask us questions about anything that they'd like to know.
And Linda, the first person that they say hello to when they stop in and get surrounded by all this history is this nice lady.
Yes.
Can you tell us about her?
Yes, RISBY is a volunteer. What we do is we have work campers that come here and volunteer their time for exchange of a work camping site. Their rig is parked right behind the museum. Mm-hmm. So she comes in 3 days a week and volunteers as a guide and welcoming committee, if you will, for the museum.
Outstanding. Arisby, yes. What's the one spot inside the museum that you want to show us first?
That I want to show you first personally?
Yes.
Okay. This is my third day of the job. But so far my favorite part is the early pioneer live era. Right over here where you have the like the little kitchen area. And on the other side, we have a little beauty salon, and people would go to some extremes to look beautiful. And well, I think we still do.
How about if you show that? I'll take care of the counter for a minute.
Okay.
Please.
Let's do it. We can go right over here if you guys want to follow. This looks like a device made to torture people, but it actually curls your hair. And I think it's crazy what we used to do for fashion and what we still do for fashion. Guys, I don't know, that looks scary to me. But this is my favorite thing so far. It has nothing to do with logging, but it's great.
People come up to this and say, oh, it's a stump. You know, thinking that, you know, we normally think of it as a stump. It's not. This was came in, a log came into family sawmill. This was cut from it, about halfway up the tree. This formation you see around it, as is described here in these captions, was actually created by woodpeckers, sapsuckers, for probably centuries, pecking around this rim to get the sap. That was what they were feeding on. And when it came into our mill, we realized this was a very unique sort of feature. And so that's why we cut it out of the tree, and my uncle took it into his home workshop and made this what you might call a heavy-duty table. He put these casters on it down here so it could roll it around, and he used it as a table in his shop until the museum was formed, and he donated to the museum. And it's Doug Western Red Cedar.
I like to tell people that this is a really good example of what a tree does to defend itself. So the tree growing out and around those holes that the sapsuckers put into it, that's how it was defending itself, yeah. And still growing.
So it's a, you know, certainly a unique sort of a feature. Some site you would see this sort of feature on a tree frequently, but never in this sort of very concentric, almost like it was designed to be this way, like my uncle said. A classical Greek column. Way to describe it.
Hey. Tom, I have some experience in the timber industry and know that when we first started timber harvesting in the region, they didn't have the kind of transportation we have today. Railroads were the way that you got back and forth, but one thing that was important at any camp was to have a good food service. Can you talk to us about
well,
that?
Well, we can go over here and you're going to see a stove. This stove originally came from the camp that was built to support the construction of the upper dam on the Elwha River.
Oh, yeah.
The Glennis Canyon Dam. The one that was most recently removed. And then after that dam was constructed, it was moved to a logging camp in the area and spent some time there. And then it was presumably retired, probably sometime right around the beginning of the First World War, we think. Or Second World War, excuse me. And the National Park Service stored it somewhere in Port Angeles, in a warehouse, we assume. And somehow it survived through the Second World War without being scrapped. And they kept it until the museum was formed in the 1980s and donated it to us. And it is quite a thing. It weighs about 2,000 pounds. This top is cast iron, about an inch thick in some places, very heavy. Three ovens. They would serve, as you see in the picture here, I would assume in the order of 100 men were being cooked for on this thing. And what's most interesting about it to me is that if you look at it, This is the firebox. This is where they built the fire, the wood fire. It's very small. It's, you know, like a small, about the size of a small wood stove to heat this entire stove. And the way it worked was that the flue gases would come from the firebox all the way under the cooktop here, down and then back underneath the ovens, and then up the flue. Well, you can imagine that in order to get this thing heated up, it took, that little firebox had to work pretty hard. And so we assume that once you got this stove up to temperature, you never let that fire go out. Because it would have been, you know, as I say, a major undertaking to get it back into operation, and so that you, these heavy cooktops would be in the appropriate temperature. Plus the fact that in order to get the flue like this to draw, to get it heated up, you would have to get that, get all that gas, all that smoke would have to do that circulation and back up that flue. And until it was drawing, if you opened this door, you were going to fill the room with smoke, just like any wood stove when you light it. So one other reason why you would never let a fire go out in this thing. But you can imagine what those kitchens must have been like in the summer.
Well, in addition to, this is the way that you had to feed a very hungry crew.
Yeah.
I see that you also have some, I'm sorry?
6,000 to 9,000 calories a day is what a typical logger would eat. They were working hard, and there weren't any fat ones.
And right next to this display, Linda, it's showing us what it was like to live in a logging camp. Can you share that with us?
You can imagine in a bunkhouse of this size, and this would have been for a large camp. They didn't have the luxury of building a building like this for a small camp, but when they had one, you can imagine what it must have been like in that camp bunkhouse. They had a stove to keep it warm, and the guys, from the stories I've heard, didn't change very often. You could tell from the shininess of his pants that those would probably stand up by themselves. I've heard stories of guys that never changed their socks. They would put new ones right over the old ones just to stay warm. So you can imagine in a bunk like this that it must have been quite interesting to be in there, and the smell must have been quite entertaining.
Very different.
Very different. But this is a very good example of what a bunkhouse would have looked like in a bigger camp.
So how many people would be in this space?
It depended on how many bunks they could fit in there. I would think that they had upwards of a dozen sometimes in a box this size.
And how big is this room? You know, what are we talking, 10, 12 foot by 6 foot? It's not a very big room.
Not very big.
Not at all.
I would think it would be that size at the largest.
But you can see in that picture there were bunks along probably one side, one wall.
And, okay.
So it was cramped space, but you would have had to have a space for the stove, just like that one, to keep it warm, and a place to store their clothes.
And then, Tom, I see right next to this, we've got some display of some of the tools that were used at the time. And I'm wondering, is this actually a saw? Is this an early version?
That's what's called a drag saw.
A drag saw.
This was the first example of an effort to mechanize the process of actually cutting logs, sawing logs. It's something to replace the hand saws like this.
Mm-hmm.
This thing would be, you can see a picture on the wall here shows one set up against the log to cut it. And it was used, the only thing it was used for, of course, was to make these vertical cuts, to do what's called bucking a log. And so this when this thing was running, basically it was pulling that saw blade you see there back and forth, just like the crosscut saws were, but just fast. And of course it was a heavy blade, so it would cut faster than you could cut with a hand saw. So it would work, although as you see, it basically looks like a wheelbarrow. You see a wheel in the front here, handles in back, but it was heavy. It would have been, you know, difficult to move around. It wasn't very portable. And besides that, it was only useful for cutting bucking. In other words, when you had a log on the ground and you were cutting it in length, it could not be used to cut a tree down, to fall a tree. In other words, to make the horizontal cuts that one had to make when you cut a tree down. You still had to depend on the old hand crosscut saws like you see on the wall here. It wasn't until they actually got chainsaws that you could actually have something that would replace the hand saws for cutting down trees, and that came on some years later. This is a kit tractor made from a Model T chassis. During the 1920s and during the Depression, the world was full of old Model T Fords. Millions had been sold prior to that, and on many farms there was probably an old Model T, and during that time there were numerous kits that were sold to convert a Model T car into a usable farm tractor. This was one of them. We think it was based on a what was called a Knickerbocker tractor kit, or Knickerbocker Forma tractor kit. And Sears and Roebuck and Montgomery Ward also sold one, but we think this is probably looks like the most practical version because it had these very large rear wheels like you see on modern tractors, except it doesn't have rubber tires, of course. It used the axle of the Model T to drive a large ring gear that you see inside here, so that you would get about a 10-to-1 reduction in speed, so you end up with a tractor which could have really been able to pull hard, because it would have had very, very, very low gear. And so it would have been a real tractor, even though, you know, Model Ts weren't very powerful cars. Because of that low gear reduction, it still would have been able to do some serious work. And one of the main benefits of it was these kits only cost about $250, which back then was still a lot of money. But compared to the price of a brand new tractor, which would probably have been in the order of $1,000, it was a real bargain. And so these things were very popular in the Depression when people were having a tough time making ends meet. And this came from the collection of Ted Spolstra, one of the local loggers here, who had an enormous collection of old artifacts, and he was kind enough to loan this to us for the park, for the museum. Quite an old piece of equipment. It actually came from a farm over in around Arlington, over in the Cascades. It was not local here. Ted brought it over here for his collection. So that's something that we think is very interesting, and a lot of people are quite amused to see it, something like this, hear its story. Okay.
Well, you've had an opportunity to see just a small portion of the collection that we have here at the Forks Timber Museum. We are open daily until 4 p.m. It is a $3 admission for anyone over the age of 12. We do offer free admission to military, but come down and take a look at the rest of everything that we have to offer. Lookout Tower, more information on logging upstairs, a little bit about the Native tribes, and we have a website, ForksTimberMuseum.org, so check us out there. But please come down and visit us. If you have any questions, you can reach us at 360-374-9663.
I hope you've enjoyed this episode of the Clallam County Report. Really, really fantastic resources in the Timber Museum and the Visitor Center, and I hope very much that you have an opportunity to visit it, and I hope very much that you'll join us in our next show in another spot here in Clallam County. Thank you again.